Hachette Audio presents an RDA audio production of The ABCs of Buying Rental Property by Ken McElroy, read by Garrett Sutton. Foreword by Robert Kiyosaki, read by Steve Stratton. The Definition of Intelligence. Kenny and I met during the Great Flipper Fest. The Real Estate Flipper Fest played out between the years 1997 and 2007. You know you are in a flipper fest when you're standing in line at a supermarket and the checkout clerk, now a realtor, hands you his or her business card, winking, nodding, and saying, "Call me," while they're bagging your groceries. During the decade-long Flipper Fest, Kim and I explained to countless people we do not flip real estate property, we are real estate investors. I remember walking through the Phoenix airport when a woman recognized me and said, "I have a 3-bedroom, 2-bath house I just bought for $86,000. If you give me $5,000 cash, I'll let you have it." "And what would I do with it?" I asked her. She looked at me like I had holes in my head, saying, "Flip it." "I don't flip real estate," I replied politely. "And I thought you were a big-time real estate investor," she said to me, sneering indignantly. Her parting shot? "You're just like everyone else, a big fat phony." Meeting Ken McElroy was the proverbial breath of fresh air. My wife Kim and I nearly cried when Ken said, "I don't flip real estate either." And when Ken followed those words with, "I invest for cash flow," we knew we had found a partner. My favorite definition for the word intelligence: if you agree with me, you are intelligent. That made Ken McElroy, in our minds, the most intelligent person in the world. When a person quickly flips a house, they're subject to ordinary income taxes. If they do enough flips, payroll taxes are added on. When investing for cash flow, an educated real estate investor can invest for both lower capital gains taxes and cash flow and pay little to nothing in taxes legally. An educated cash flow investor also knows how to flip a property and minimize, if not avoid entirely, flipper taxes legally. An uneducated flipper will likely always pay the highest taxes. Since the day we met, Ken, Kim, and I have acquired numerous apartment complexes across the southwestern United States, totaling over 7,000 rental units at a cost of over $500 million, using OPM, debt financing, earning us millions a year in income, with most of that income tax-free. On the day we met Ken, not only did Kim and I meet a very intelligent person, we gained a business partner, a fellow teacher, and a lifelong friend. Almost every week, someone will approach me and say, "Because of your books, I'm getting into real estate." And whenever I hear those words, I smile, thank them for saying hello and reading my books. I also warn them: be careful. Invest in your financial education before investing in real estate. Unfortunately, rarely do I have the time to explain why I say be careful. The following are a few of the reasons for my warnings, and why I encourage everyone to invest first in their real estate education before they invest in real estate. Real estate is the best investment in the world, in my opinion, for the following reasons. 1. Real estate is about investing with debt, or OPM, other people's money. 2. Real estate can generate cash flow income for years. 3. It's likely you could pay little, if anything, in taxes. 4. We can find opportunities and buy more real estate when markets crash, often acquiring the properties of flippers. Real estate is the worst investment in the world for the following reasons. 1. Real estate is illiquid. That means if you make a mistake, real estate can be extremely difficult to sell or sell quickly. If you make a mistake in stocks, bonds, mutual funds, or ETFs, you can liquidate easily, which means you can sell quickly and cut losses almost instantly. If you make a mistake in real estate, you may go down with the Titanic. 2. Real estate is a business. Real estate requires real business skills and a business mind. Real estate is management intensive. Many real estate dreams turn into real estate nightmares, not because real estate is bad, but because the investor's business skills are bad. 3. Real estate is not for do-it-yourselfers. Stock, bond, and mutual fund investors can get away with being do-it-yourselfers. Real estate investing is about rules, regulations, laws, records, repairs, losses, and management. Real estate is about debt, and debt can be a loaded gun. Debt can make you very rich or kill you. Real estate is a business that requires debt financing and professional management, which is why real estate investing is a team sport played by a team of professionals. Professional real estate investors must have a bookkeeper, lawyer, accountant, and insurance agent on their team. 4. Real estate is about maintenance and repairs. Real estate investors must have a handyman on call 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, unless the investor enjoys fixing toilets at midnight. These are the reasons why Ken McElroy's real estate books, especially this book, are priceless for beginner and advanced real estate investors alike. They will teach you how to maximize the advantages of real estate investing, because I would prefer that you become a smart and rich real estate investor rather than the captain of the SS Titanic. These are the same reason why Ken McElroy, an expert in the field of real estate investing, is our partner, advisor, and trusted friend. Robert Kiyosaki.
Part 1. How to Achieve Financial Independence. Chapter 1. A note from Ken about wealth. On occasion, people have likened me and some of my colleagues to the lead characters in a Horatio Alger novel. Fact number 1. Horatio Alger novels promoted wealth and the American dream. Alger was a 19th century American writer famous for his rags-to-riches stories, which chronicled the lives of impoverished boys who, through hard work, honesty, and perseverance, achieved financial security and sometimes great wealth. I grew up in poverty. My family never threw away anything of value, except worn shoes. My clothes were hand-me-downs. When they tore, my mother would patch them. Today, I'm a wealthy man. My companies control or manage nearly $1 billion in real estate assets. I made most of my money through managing, buying, and selling rental communities. My wealth has given me and my family access to many wonderful things, like new clothes and vacations. I appreciate these things, perhaps more than others, because I know what it's like to be poor. But I have never viewed wealth as an end in itself. I don't admire my possessions like Silas Marner, the miserly character in George Eliot's novel who counted gold coins. An orphaned girl eventually redeemed him. Wealth is a means to an end, not the end itself. What I cherish most about wealth isn't the things it can buy, but the freedom it gives, especially the freedom to spend more time with the people I love. Tip number 1. Wealth gives you freedom. I visit my mother and other relatives who live 1,700 miles away, at least 8 times a year. In my free time, I also enjoy sports, writing books, and giving to charity. Nothing is more important in life than relationships. No amount of money can replace the love of family, friends, and colleagues. Studies even show that people on their deathbed often regret working too much and wish they had spent more time with loved ones. Definition number 1. Financial freedom exists when your income is sufficient enough that you no longer worry about your finances. Of course, I cannot guarantee you'll get wealthy after listening to this or any of my other books about real estate investing, but I can assure you that financial freedom is a very realistic goal, and you can do it in 5 to 10 years, or 20 if you prefer to go more slowly. To achieve that freedom, you don't have to be super smart although I know you are, have a fancy education, all of life is an education, or have a lot of money. A little is helpful, especially for your first purchase. You don't even need to buy a big apartment building. You can do it, one rental home or condo at a time. To be financially independent, you just need three things. 1. A motivation to succeed. 2. A good work ethic. And 3. A willingness to learn about real estate and from your mistakes. I discuss these topics in Chapter 3. First, though, I need to convince you that real estate is one of the best and safest ways to achieve financial independence. Chapter 2 will show you, using data from the U.S. Census and other governmental sources, that real estate can routinely produce returns 5 times higher than the stock market. Then, in Chapters 4 through 13, I'll show you, through 10 simple steps, how to set up a real estate business, get your investment money, find a good property to purchase, manage your property, reduce your costs, increase your revenues, build your real estate portfolio, and continue your education. Tip number 2. To be financially free, you need motivation, a good work ethic, and a willingness to learn. To enhance the learning process, I'll use examples and anecdotes. I'll introduce you to John, one of my acquaintances, who, at age 65, decided to purchase his first rental property. Although this book uses examples mostly from the United States, the steps and principles are applicable to virtually all free market countries in the world. Along the way, I'll also offer some stories about how I achieved financial independence. I offer these stories not to brag, but to convince you that, if John and I can do it, you can too. Chapter 2. Why Real Estate is a Superior Investment. There are lots of ways to financial freedom. The fastest and easiest is to be born to rich parents. Fact number 2. Being born to rich parents is the fastest way to wealth, but real estate beats all other paths. About half of the wealth in America comes through inheritance. But if you, like me, weren't lucky enough to be born to rich parents, don't despair. We have other paths to financial freedom. We can climb, or should I say claw, our way up the corporate ladder, invest in stocks or bonds or mutual funds, write a best-selling novel, start up a business, fix up homes, or win the lottery. Earning a top executive position in a corporation is prestigious, but usually takes a long time. Stocks can be volatile. Bonds, annuities, and mutual funds often offer less than satisfactory returns. Writing a novel is hard work, and only a few books make the New York Times best-selling list. Starting a new business is exciting, but 2/3 of them fail, often leaving their owners bankrupt. Fixing up homes can be lucrative, but it's a lot of hard work, and your profits are heavily taxed. And the lottery, well, your odds of striking it big are 1,800 times less than being killed by lightning. Each wealth stream has advantages over the others. Lottery tickets are cheap, after all. But none has a better track record than real estate. And to prove it, I'll first compare real estate to stock investments. Then I'll elaborate on 10 financial reasons why real estate is financially superior to stocks and most other forms of investment. A tale of two investments. One of the most enduring beliefs in American culture is that the stock market beats all other investments over the long run in terms of returns. A recent story in Forbes magazine, for example, recommends readers invest in stocks first. But this is a myth. Myth number 1. The stock market is the fastest way to wealth. Since 1940, the Dow Jones Industrial Average has produced an average annual return of 6.6%. That's not bad, but it won't get you to financial freedom very quickly. If you invested $35,000 in the stock market today, it would take you 52 years to turn that into $1 million.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.